Welcome to How Science Happens, a podcast by Wally Paxton, DJ So, and Doug Tree, professors at Brigham Young University. In the podcast, we bring you stories of cutting-edge science as told by world-class scientists and engineers from around the world who are on the front lines doing the work. We explore the highs and lows of discovery and what makes science such an exhilarating and frustrating process for those who do it. And because we're nerds, maybe we'll even learn a little science along the way.
Hey everyone, welcome to another episode of How Science Happens. So my name is DJ Saw. I'm one of your hosts today. I'm also with Wally. Wally, can you say hello?
Hello, everybody. Okay.
I'm also with the Doug Tree. Say hello to everybody, Doug.
Hey, everybody.
Okay. So I'm excited to have Xiaoguang Wang. Also, he goes by William. So yeah, I'm going to call him William if he doesn't mind. So William has a bachelor's degree and a master's degree in chemical engineering from Zhejiang University. I'm hoping that I'm pronouncing that right as well. He has a PhD in chemical engineering from University of Wisconsin-Madison in 2016. So his PhD research was with Professor Nicholas Abbott. It's focused on liquid crystals. And also, he did a postdoc at Harvard University with Professor Joanna Eisenberg. Beginning 2019, he's working at Ohio State University as an assistant professor of chemical engineering. So William, it's great to have you today. So can you say hello to our audience today?
Sure, yeah, hello everyone. First, Dongjin, thank you very much for your kind invitation, introduction, and also hi Wally and Doug, nice to meet you guys virtually today.
Good to meet you too.
Yeah.
Thank you for your time. I'm excited to hear from you. But first of all, I know that you have done a lot of exciting research. So then you're definitely an assistant professor, you have a PhD, but we'd like to know how you become the kind of scientist you are right now. So it's obvious that you're from China. So, and also you went to the Zhejiang University. So is that where your hometown is, or where did you grow up?
Sure. Yeah. I was not born in Hangzhou. I was born in Tianjin, a very big city next to the capital of China, Beijing. So say my hometown, Tianjin, has a very long, rich history and a population of over 15 million people. Imagine, right? China, mainland. Yeah.
So and a pretty good university there too, right?
Exactly. So Tianjin University ranked a top one or at least a top two in chemical engineering, in my major. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I miss my hometown very much. Tianjin have a lot of ancient, historical, landmarks. And also Dongjin, since the location, there are many Korean companies in Tianjin.
Oh, Tianjin?
Samsung, LG, Hyundai. What do you call that one? LAT, right? Those companies, they are in China. So when I was a kid, in my childhood, my neighbor, they were from South Korea. So that's why I know how to speak South Korean a little bit, Kansahamida, Hanyasu.
Okay.
say that a little bit.
I should have learned about Chinese. All I can say is Ni Hao. It's all I can say about Chinese.
And that's all I can say in Chinese.
But that's a very friendly thing to learn if you're going to know it.
You know, but you know what? But I can read Chinese letters. My name is in Chinese letters as well. So.
Oh yes. Yeah.
I don't speak Chinese. This is a problem.
Sure. Mm-hmm. So then about Hangzhou. So yeah, actually in China, you guys know that in China, we have a super difficult, highly competitive national college entrance examination. Mm-hmm. I think in South Korea, we have the same thing.
So compared to China, India, it's nothing. But seriously, China, India, they're crazy hard.
So actually eventually I went to Zhejiang University for my bachelor and master. I would say two reasons. The first reason, I think I did a pretty good job in that entrance exam, but I'm not the top one or top two. So I did not get chance to go to Tsinghua University or Beijing University, those are the top two universities in China. So Zhejiang University, they rank a third or the fourth in China. So that's one biggest reason. Another reason is in my hometown, Tianjin, my house is very close to my elementary school, middle school, high school, and also very close to Tianjin University. So I can imagine, like, if I still stayed like in my hometown, maybe my whole life gonna be, let's say, within a radius of maybe 5 miles. That's all my life. I just want to, let's say, like, maybe escape from my house. Just want to see.
So you wanna get away from your parents, huh?
If you stay with them, let's say, for maybe 18 years, maybe you also want to breath, take some breath, fresh air, right?
So you graduated from, elementary school, middle school, high school from Tianjin, huh?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, very close. Every day I just like a bicycle, I bike. So they are very close.
All right. So, but this is interesting, but I mean, so you definitely decide to, so in Korea, when you, after you take the entrance exam, so you got the score, the reader score, you applied to schools and the majors. So did you apply for chemical engineering in Zhejiang University?
Yes. So that's my first choice. However, I did not know like what chemical engineering was like back in those days. And so the reason is in China, in the second year of middle school, I would say it's kind of like the grade 7 or grade 8 in United States.
Okay, so in China, it's a 6-year elementary, 3-year middle school, 3-year high school.
Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly.
Okay.
So kind of like in China, compared to United States, like in 8th grade. We started learning physics, and I used to be very bad at physics. And in the next year, so we have like a chemistry. I just feel like I cannot have like a both to like an object where like a subject like a failed. So that's why I spend a lot of time on chemistry. That's why like after the national college like entrance exam, so I still want to choose some field related to chemistry. And then like, for example, like in China, sounds like to me, like a chemical engineering make me feel like, okay, if I work in this field in the future, I can have my own like a factory or plant, I can earn a lot of money and I can be a rich man. So that's why I end up with like a chemical engineering. But then like after I grow up, like I realize if I have those money, I wish to like buy stock, like buy house, I'll spend those money, like to build a plant, like build a plant. That's like it's too complicated. But anyway, that's how I end up with chemical engineering.
Okay, but I mean, so by the way, so it's this podcast is about you, but it's less about me. But let me tell you my story. So I chose chemical engineering because I don't like quantum physics. I don't like statistical mechanics. This is really why I chose chemical engineering. My wife actually got basically admitted to a chemical engineering program. But the first day of a class, her professor told her, but not to her, to her class, that if you are here for the chemistry, this is the wrong place. Because the chemical engineering is more about physics and mathematics than chemistry. This is what her professor told her. But you said that you didn't like physics, but eventually you got stuck in the chemical engineering. So what's up with that? So did you realize it is more about physics than chemistry in chemical engineering?
Exactly. So actually, like, for example, if I got a chance to go back to, let's say, go back to the school, and if I could like retake some of the courses, I can let you know the top two courses I wish I can like a retake or take. Even I should not say retake because I've never taken those courses before. One is quantum physics. The other one is condensed matter physics. Actually, those are something like right now, like I'm currently working on. So like you can imagine this is life, right? I hate physics. I choose chemistry. But like eventually I end up with physics. I cannot throw it away. Yeah.
Yeah,
well, these sciences kind of come together, and chemistry and physics for sure. There's a lot of overlap.
Yes,
exactly, and also like a math. Like to be honest, I think like you guys can imagine. Like for example, if one people they are not very good at physics, I mean, it is very likely that they also like a very not good at math. However, so now in chemical engineering, where let's say we work on either science or engineering, sometimes we need to use the most precise language on this like planet, which is mass, to describe the rule we found in our experiments. So that's the case. So now I still like learn like a I learned like a physics, like condensed matter physics by myself. Like I learned that one by myself during my PhD. I also like try to pick up some of the mass I learned before. So yeah, it's really interesting.
Yeah. So I mean, you just told me about your ambition of why you just decided to major chemistry. You're by a plan, you know, because make a lot of money, but for some reason you decide to do the master's in the same university. So why did you decide to get a master's degree? So one of the questions here is, when you decide to get a master's degree, did you decide to continue to PhD, or you thought that, okay, master's degree is good enough? So what was your plan when you decided to go to graduate school?
Okay, yeah, I wish I could say, for example, like when I was a kid, I want to devote my whole life and myself into science. However, that's not the story. So like actually in my bachelor, or toward the end of my bachelor, I feel like I was not ready for finding a job. That's why I have to give myself like a several or a few more years to prepare. And actually for me, I have no internship experience, or I even did not work in any research lab when I was an undergrad. I just like go to the course, like I try to get A in all my courses, but I did not have any like a lab experience. Another very important reason is in China, like for every bachelor, we need to do thesis, like to graduate. We cannot really graduate without any thesis. So in the second half of my senior, like a bachelor year, I worked in the lab and I did super bad job. And so in my also like my defense, bachelor defense, like so I got a lot of tough questions, and I still remember like one Chinese professor, I don't believe he's gonna listen to this podcast, but like so he also say like, hey William, you see you did a pretty good job in your course, but did you see how bad job you did like in your defense? And like so just like make me feel like I do not want to leave this place as a loser, like that's why I want to stay there. And also like the way I choose my master advisor, I think it's also like it's also a little bit like unusual. So I just stay inside my like a dorm. I did not like go outside or try to find any like did not talk to a lot of like faculty members. So one day, like one of my friends, he just said like, hey, William, do you want to talk to like my advisor? I think he's nice. I just went there. I talked to like a Professor Law, and Professor Law, he told me like, hey, William, you did a pretty good job in your course. You have high GPA. Why don't you think about, let's say, go to the United States, try to study abroad? You should go to a better place. This statement really hurt me. Come on, I want to work with you, but you say I should go to other place.
Go away.
I will work with you. That's the way I choose my master advisor.
Yeah.
But in my master, my field is completely different from what I've been working on right now. So in my master, I'm a polymer guy. So I work on like polymer material, polymer synthesis. I know like how to make some high performance coating for the building, like coating, like yeah, for example, for the regular thermal expansion or contraction, like in summer, in winter, those coating, they will not crack. So so that's like my master topic. Yeah.
Okay, so I mean, but it's more about polymer synthesis than polymer characterization. Okay.
Yes, it's called like the terminology is called the emulsion polymerization, like that one to make the coating. Yeah.
Okay, Doug is polymer guy. Hi, Doug.
Yeah, emulsion polymerization sounds awesome.
Yeah. So one thing interesting about China is I didn't know that you have to defend your bachelor's thesis, because even though in many universities require the bachelor's students to actually write and they have to be reviewed by the faculty members, but they don't usually defend the bachelor's thesis. So does everyone have to defend their thesis before they graduate?
Yes, maybe you feel like, let's say, that's the some interesting part, Euro part, or the good part of like maybe, for example, the way like how China graduates bachelors. But to me, just for myself, like I think I told you guys, like I did a pretty bad job in my defense. And the worst thing is the way Zhejiang University, they graduated their like a bachelor's. When I gave the talk, all my, let's say the peer, the same, like the undergrad students, like with the same year as all my peers, they just sit there, they listen. So they do that one by one. So there is no open and closed section. So all the students, they got like a, they also like a hear the questions, those faculty members through to me. So you can, yeah, because like my GPA is like a top two in my whole year. So in my year, there are more than 100 undergrad students. So I ranked the top two. But like I had a nightmare, like a bachelor defense, like in my life. So that's why I do not want just like a disappear. So I want to stay. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But eventually your master's advisor asked you to leave. But more like he encouraged you to go to somewhere else for the PhD. So you didn't like that because you want to stay there, but why did you eventually choose to do PhD in somewhere else?
Even let's say after I almost finished my master degree, I never thought about to be a faculty member in the future. I just feel like, for example, I really appreciate the time and the efforts that my master advisor spent on me. But I just try to like get improved. And someone told me, like, if I work with my advisor forever, I will get infinitely close to that guy, but I can never surpass that guy. So that's why I try to, let's say, for example, maybe learn with some other people, because I want to get better and better. I do not want to, let's say, for myself, have an upper limit for myself. That's why eventually I decided to start a board.
So, but I'm curious. So we had an interview like this many times, but people choose advisors. Sometimes people use university. Sometimes teachers choose a location because, you know, I want to go to California and I want to have some fun. And why is it a PhD? So why did you choose Wisconsin Medicine, or why did you choose your advisor forever? So what was your decision process for going to use Wisconsin Medicine?
Yeah, that's also a very good question. So I'm not sure, maybe it's also like it depends on myself. Since I was from Tianjin, a very huge like a city. So I'm a little bit, let's say, few enough with large population. So that's why I don't care location too much. And also, like, you know, Tianjin, close to South Korea. So I got used to the cold weather. So Zhejiang, like Hangzhou, is like in south part of China, next to Shanghai. Like the weather is more pleasant, but it's very humid, very hot. So I don't like that like weather. So that's why I I don't mind to go to, for example, north of like United States, like for my PhD. And like when I make my decision, I just like download the US news. I see the department ranking, and all the offers. Yeah, Wisconsin Medicine ranked I think fifth or sixth in my year. So I eventually end up with it.
But you chose a department then.
Yes, I chose department. I did not choose university. Yeah.
Okay. So what about then? What did you decide to work? Personal ever, because I mean, did you like him, or did you like his project, or you said you did polymer synthesis? Right now he's working with the liquid crystal. So why did you choose personal ever?
Yeah, so I would say I need to be careful with my statement. I like him, of course. Like he's the best PhD advisor. It's something I must say. After I got the offer from Wisconsin Medicine, before I departed to United States, I spent around 2 months to read, I think in total, almost like 400 papers from three faculty members in Department of Wisconsin Medicine, ChemE.
That's some serious background reading.
Thank you. Yeah, so like actually I hesitate between Professor Ebert and another two faculty member. One faculty member focused more on polymer physics, The other faculty member focused more on polymer chemistry synthesis. So so I, let's say in medicine, so I talked to all of these like three faculty members, but eventually I chose like Professor Ebert because of the research he proposed. So he mentioned to me, if I join his group, I can work on one project. That idea is super cool. Maybe some of the terminology. So he told me like, hey, William, if I join his group, I'm gonna work on a topic called, we use a terminology called a topological defects. Defects sounds like imperfection, nobody liked that. Mm-hmm. But we try to use topological defects in a material called a liquid crystal to direct molecular self-assembly. I mean, come on, to me, oh, this is really cool, like defects, nobody liked that one, but we can take advantage of these things. Oh, I think that's really like a, this idea is really smart. I cannot, let's say no to this project. And like, so that's why like I selected him as my advisor. And I remember in our next meeting, then like, I just like stopped by his office. I say like, hey, Professor Ebert, thank you so much for like accepting me to your group. I really like this like idea, it's super cool. Then I say like, hey, Professor Ebert, can you let me know like what do you want to do with like this like a system? For example, which topological defect I should begin with? Then he say, ah, William, this is your project. You need to find like to work. And then I say, I say, sure, like, okay, I will do more literature searching. And then I say, like, hey, Professor Edward, which like molecules do you think we should choose? He's like, come on, this is also like a your like a question. I just gave you this concept. So, yeah, so this is the start of my PhD. Yeah.
So when did you get the idea about becoming a professor? Because you told me that you never thought about becoming a faculty member. But when did you start having an idea about being a faculty member? What is so good about being a faculty member?
Yeah, I would say toward the end of my PhD. I think toward the end of my PhD, I feel like, okay, maybe I'm like a productive in research. I also feel like I really have interest in let's say in science or in research. So then I think, okay, maybe I'm suitable to be a faculty member. For me, like I don't mind, let's say, if I be a faculty member either in the United States or China, but like, but I think toward the end of my PhD, I made the decision. I told myself, yes, I really want to just like spend the rest of my life in this field. I like to research, try to explore something new. Yeah.
Is it the reason why you decided to do postdoc? So that you can further your career? That's the reason why you decided to postdoc?
Yeah, so for postdoc, the way I look at a postdoc is I try to use postdoc to see what else do I need to improve. Actually, like today, maybe the paper we're gonna discuss, without the training of my postdoc, like I cannot like succeed with that work. I have to say that work is a perfect example of combining what I did in my PhD, like a liquid crystal, and also my training in my postdoc is the is the concept of like a slippery surface. Yes.
Yeah. So by the way, you mentioned your paper we're gonna talk about. So today we're gonna talk about your paper, which is titled as a liquid crystal based open surface microfluidics manipulate liquid mobility and the chemical composition on demand. So my feeling is that you got this. You have knowledge about how to deal with the liquid crystal from Professor Abbott. And you got the idea about this active surface from Professor Eisenberg. Am I right?
Yes, exactly.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think it's a great example because you got some skill expertise from one place, you got another expertise in another place, and you're combining them together. You're making your own field. Okay? Okay, so I just read the title from the paper. By the way, this paper is in Science Advance in 2021. So, but you know, title is really long. So what about we break down the title first? So you in here, it says there's a word, there's a liquid crystal. So people kind of know liquid crystal. So let's go over that. And the open surface microfluidics. So what does that mean? So does that mean there's a closed surface microfluidics and that means there's open surface microfluidics? What are the difference?
Sure. Yeah. So actually, like for myself, sometimes like as a faculty member, my idea also like it keep like changing all the time. For example, if you ask me to, if I could republish this paper, I think I may go with like some other like concept, not this one. However, like for example, for the terminology you just like bring up, open surface microfluidics. So like to me, just like one day when I watch my kids, they are playing what we call the race track. So those like a toy, I feel like they can easily put like a race track together and then like they build a track so they can just like run their like a toy car. I got the idea, for example, can I use a single water droplet as a, for example, chemical reactor? However, mm-hmm. for this like a single water droplet chemical reactor, what I want to do, I want this droplet can also like a slide across like a different, for example, area. And for example, mm-hmm. in area one, it can pick up chemical A and it mm-hmm. can move on, go to the next area, can pick up chemical B, and we can just do like whatever I want. So for such a system, people call that open surface microfluidics, which means like, for example, people know, maybe people not call that closed surface microfluidics. People just call that in-channel microfluidics. For example, in biofield, the people use PDMS, piece of glass slide, they can make a lot of channel. They can generate, let's say, droplet reactors, and they can change the composition inside that droplet. And they have a lot of many kind of like application from material synthesis to like a biomedical application. However, like for me, like in-channel microfluidics, I mean, super, like it's have been very well like established. However, like sometimes like we know when we try to make those like in-channel microfluidics, people use a very clean room, people use photolithography, mm-hmm. people try to make that one. So my thinking is if we can, for example, just like have some open surface, we put them together, we can easily make some microfluidic device and we can just like run the droplet on them. I think that would be mm-hmm. super, that would be very like interesting and also like very economic, but in particular for a system professor, right? Like because we are still fighting for external funding. So so that's like how we get that idea. We try to make that one. So it's called like open surface microfluidics. Back to let's say 2021, some paper already published, not a lot. And the main challenge what I found is it's not very easy to precisely control the chemical release from this bottom, let's say the solid surface, to the water droplet on the top. So in other words, in some of the paper, the chemical could be released. However, after release, the water droplet will get a pin on the surface. It's very hard to
further move them. They will get stuck.
Sure. It's really hard for them to further move from this piece to the next piece. So that's how like maybe based on this explanation, I think maybe now the title, hopefully now the title makes a little bit more sense to you. So that's why we say we try to develop this liquid crystal based surface, which we can control both the water droplet mobility and let's say we can control the chemical release. Yes.
This sounds a little bit like what was called digital microfluidics, and maybe it still is, where you're taking individual droplets and instead of an entire channel filled with fluid, you're taking one droplet, confined volume, and then you're manipulating that droplet around. And so if it gets stuck somewhere, you can't move it around where it needs to go. And so this is one of the challenges that you guys are addressing. Is that right?
Exactly. Okay, exactly.
So you have two problems. You can easily, so you like to have a reactor inside the water droplet. The problem is after the reaction, it got pinned. So my question is, how do you solve the problem? So it seems like you solved the problem with your liquid crystal. So how did the liquid crystal help you solve the mobility problem?
Sure. Yeah. So that is exactly the question I bring from Wisconsin Madison to let's say Harvard, like when I did my postdoc. So actually in the last year of my PhD, I participated in one project and we have like one paper eventually published in Nature. So in that paper, what we reported is we can use some, let's say, environmental cues like a temperature or like some charge we can trigger the release of the chemicals preloaded in the liquid crystal film to the environment, like water.
Okay.
So we succeed with that one. However, for liquid crystal, this is like a very interesting material. I know like you are from like a Korea, you are familiar with like a liquid crystal LCD, mm-hmm. like very popular. For this material, like it has been widely used in display technology. However, liquid crystal have some very interesting, let's say, molecular structure. And also its, let's say, surface tension wettability is also very interesting. So what I'm saying is, so in my PhD, like my PhD advisor, Professor Everett, he's very famous at the design of liquid crystal sensors. So for example, in the water, if there are some, let's say, very low concentration of some toxins, some like toxic compounds, liquid crystal can sense them and the liquid crystal can change their, let's say, property. And we can use the naked eye to read out, okay, there are something, let's say, bad in the water.
Hmm.
However, like in my whole PhD, when we try to prepare those liquid crystal sensors, we need not a very easy way to stabilize the liquid crystal against the dewetting
mm-hmm.
by the surrounding aqueous phase. For example,
so liquid crystal like to dewet the liquid?
So for example, let's say if we grab a piece of glass slide, mm-hmm. and if we, I mean, whatever, let's say surface functionalization, let's say we can do, we can make mm-hmm. the surface more hydrophobic, means
yeah.
we can make the surface more oil-like, it's like oil.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Then we spin, we coat a thin film of liquid crystal on it. And then if we immerse this like a liquid crystal coated glass under water, water will wet the surface. Liquid crystal will de-wet from the surface.
Oh, I didn't know that. Mm.
Yeah, this has been a very long-term challenge. So that's why in my PhD, if we try to get a stable, let's say, liquid crystal film underwater, we need, for example, use some, let's say, like a copper grade or gold grade that people use in transmission electron microscope. We try to use like a capillary force to hold a very, let's say, small area liquid crystal against the dewetting by water droplet. So mm-hmm. This is the trouble. And then in the first year of my PhD, so Professor Joanne Eisenberg, she gave a seminar talk at Wisconsin Madison. So she learned from nature, in particular is a plant called like a pitcher plant. So mm-hmm. the pitcher plant, they use some, let's say, hierarchical, but let's say nanoscopic porous structure. They can stabilize a very thin film of liquid on the surface, on the skin of that plant. That's why the pitcher plant, the surface is very like a slippery, like a mosquito bug, like a fly. Mm-hmm. They cannot, let's say, stack or stand still on the plant surface. So they're gonna fall into the pocket and get, let's say, caught by the pitcher plant. Yeah, I'm thinking like, oh, this idea is exactly what I'm looking for. I really want to use the nature-inspired strategy, try to stabilize liquid crystal against the dewetting by another like a liquid. Yeah, mm. so this is like exactly the key idea what I did like in this paper.
Mm. That's great. So, but can you tell me about how you solve the mobility problem? So basically the liquid crystal, so if you want to make a reactor out of a water-based reactor, then the liquid crystal like to dewet the water, so it doesn't work. That's the reason why you infuse a liquid to make it wettable. Am I right?
I would say so here the key concept is what I'm doing is I try to learn for example, from nature or from Joanna. I try to chemically functionalize or modify
the surface
of glass slide. Mm-hmm. Yes. And also we use one material with the name, whatever, it's called a poly RM257, but it doesn't matter.
Mm-hmm.
So that one is a liquid crystal polymer. So eventually what we are doing, we try to use liquid crystal polymer, try to create a nano, let's say porous, like a coating on the surface. And then we coat liquid crystal on it. So in this case, so the liquid crystal can be stabilized and the liquid crystal is very stable against the dewetting by water. And here mm-hmm. one key design is, we need to infuse or coat excess liquid crystals on the surface. So again, like for example, if we talk about the liquid mobility, where does the liquid, let's say, where does the liquid mobility come from? Where, let's say, what does the pinning come from? Mm-hmm. The key reason for the pinning is from the water solid contact.
Mm-hmm.
So like, for example, let's say we have, a wood table. If we put a drop of water on the surface, you can see, let's say, it doesn't matter how clean your, let's say, table is, the water will always, let's say, get pinned on the surface. So the key, the issue is the water solid contact. And let's say if we, for example, I did not cook a lot in my house, but if let's think about this like situation, we grab a pot, we fill with, let's say, water, we try to make some soup. We grab a pot, fill with water, and we put, let's say, maybe like a one or two drop of vegetable oil on top of the surface. If we take a close look at the oil droplet in the center or on the top of the water face, you can see the oil droplet, it's very slippery. So it can move around freely.
Okay.
However, when that oil drop touch the side wall of our pot, that oil drop, it will get pinned. So in other words, all the pinning gets stuck in is because of the liquid solid contact. So here, the key idea is we try to use a liquid crystal polymer coating to stabilize the liquid crystal. However, we need excess liquid crystal on the surface to prevent the direct contact of the water droplet we place on the top, touch either the glass slide or touch the porous, let's say, liquid crystal polymer network.
So, this is how you solve the mobility problem then.
Exactly.
Okay. All right, so I have one more question. So you have a lot of authors in your papers. So can you tell me about their roles? Because I think in science, the collaboration is very important. So what did they do? How did they contribute to this paper? And how did you find them? And this is very, I think for me, I tried to find the main collaborators, but it is interesting to find somebody in Slovenia. So
sure.
When, how did you find them?
Sure. Yeah. So actually, in that paper, I'd say the first, six or seven authors, they are my students. So I want to, either comment or acknowledge two authors. So the second last and the third last authors. So the second last, Uras Tkalik, I hope I pronounced his name correct. You mentioned that he's from Slovenia.
Slovenia.
So actually, in Slovenia, there is one institute or university, I hope my pronunciation is correct, it's a University of Ljubljana. So that university, they have very strong liquid crystal program. So their physics department is very strong. So I know Uras in one of the liquid crystal conference when I did my PhD in Professor Everett's group. And the third last author, Solomon Adrian, he used to be a postdoc in Joanna's group as well. And he is an expert on wetability. So that's why, I try to learn liquid crystal knowledge from, Wurz, and learn more wetting or wetability knowledge from Solomon. That's how we build a very strong team and get this work done.
Yeah, so the key idea is go to conference then, because this is how I met you, huh?
Yes, exactly.
All right, so I have one very last question. So this is an official question before we end our podcast. It says, so let's say you go back to your high school. So you're about to decide your major, but you cannot choose science. Okay. Then what would you like to major or what would you choose? So you cannot do chemistry, you cannot do physics. So if you want to design your career path one more time, what would you do?
Probably I would say I will go with computer science or WE. I hope I can choose those two.
But this is still science.
Maybe I will go with sports. So
okay.
For myself, my father. Oh, by the way, my family, none of my family members, they are, let's say, working in science. But my father, he used to be a professional volleyball player.
Okay.
Professional volleyball player. So actually, he told me when I grew up, he just looked at me. He think like if I can grow bigger. Thicker. Mm-hmm. Maybe he also wants me to, let's say, like some course, try to be a professional player. However, seems that, yeah. So that's why, like, for me, so now I'm like a 6'1", but I'm still, let's say, shorter than my father. Like, mm-hmm. he can easily, let's say, dunk, but I cannot.
Mm-hmm. So do you work out?
No.
Do you play soccer with other Chinese in your city?
Sorry.
Do you play soccer with other Chinese in your city?
Before I had my kids, yes. Before I had my kids, I played soccer, I played basketball. I'm a big like a sport fan, but yeah, after the kids and the whole world changed, right? So now I only play soccer with my kids.
Yeah, same here.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you very much for your time, for your inspiring story about how you decide to follow your science career and everything. Thank you so much. So our guest today has been Professor Xiaoguang Wang. Can you say your name again?
Xiaoguang Wang.
Xiaoguang Wang. Okay, thank you for joining us today, Xiaoguang. We appreciate your time, and this has been a lot of fun. I mean, you can find about him and his work in the show notes. So we're gonna leave a show note in YouTube and anchor.fm and Twitter. So please find more about him. And we can, you know, please remember, you can find us in YouTube now. So thank you for your time. As always, please press a like, subscribe, and all the things. Retweet and everything, please. Brett, thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Thanks
so much,
William.
Thank you for listening to this episode of How Science Happens with your hosts Wally Paxton, DJ So, and Doug Tree. For more information about the podcast, the hosts, or our guests, please visit our website at bit.ly/howscience. For additional comments or questions, we can be reached by email at howscience@byu.edu.